Good morning.
How's everybody? Awake? Sort of. Okay, I'm going to give a talk on taming a 1,000-pound gorilla. I'm going to tell the story of how interchange 4 and then 5 came to run all the systems at the company I work for. I'll explain what prompted me to modernize our development and the key things that helped us to do that and start migrating our code. Why is it not working? Did I say more? So back in 2001, I graduated from University of Calgary with a computer science degree and was immediately contracted by a company called Soul in Calgary to build their e-commerce site, and I was told to use interchange. I think it was the best option at the time, definitely the best open source option. What I quickly learned was that e-commerce is much more than just a web store. It involves order management, it's intimately connected to every part of the company: accounting, sales, marketing, customer service. And I also quickly realized that though I was at a young company and we were in the golden age of web, they had a mess of non-web-based systems already. So all closed databases, all very hard to integrate with, lots of closed proprietary connectors connecting them all. Having interchange at my fingertips, especially when it could do that, yep, it could do that, it could do anything. Anything that we needed at our company, it seemed to fit the bill. The first thing was simply, it was already entering orders for our web-based customers. Our accounting system had limited amount of users that could connect it at one time, so the first thing we did was have our salespeople enter orders through interchange. Our accounts liked it, kept them out of the accounting system. It worked really well. So we had a baby gorilla. next was our warehouse systems. So the orders were flowing through the system. It was all web-based. We had a big warehouse in Great Falls, Montana, in the U.S. The current way of getting them to ship product was to manually import our orders into one system and have that connected to a shipping software. Somebody at the Calgary office would print out, generate labels, email them to the warehouse. It was very cumbersome. I discovered a nice FedEx module on CPAN and integrated that with interchange, and in no time we had the warehouse directly accessing the orders through interchange, printing off labels, and shipping orders. It wasn't long after that where we realized, hey, why not try to integrate the order entry with our accounting system and have the orders automatically go into the accounting system and get invoiced. That was a pain with the closed accounting system, but why not introduce an open source accounting system to the mix? So we did that. So we had seamless order flow right from entering an order on the e-commerce site. Nobody had to really touch the order other than ship it physically. And it went straight through our systems all the way through to invoicing and payment and posting the payment. And once it was doing that, hey, why not... sorry, do you have a question?
Yeah, what system did you use for accounting?
I don't have SQL Ledger at the time, yeah. Or Ledger SMB now, as they call it, is what it's called. And then once it had all that data in there, why not use it for CRM, reporting engine because all the data was in one place. It became our single source for all of our business logic within the company. So we had a very powerful gorilla at the time. Back in about 2008, 2009, I think it was, I was at a big trade show in the US, outdoor retailer for the company, and met up with a senior developer from backcountry.com, which I think is an endpoint, still an endpoint client, was an endpoint client. I don't know if they're still using Interchange at all for anything. Talking to her, and she definitely did not share my sentiments about a very powerful gorilla. For her, it was definitely a 1,000-pound gorilla, pushing them around, telling them what they couldn't do. They were looking to get rid of it. So it was a big warning for me. It was like, okay, this thing could get out of control. This thing could become a very angry 1,000-pound gorilla if I wasn't careful. I definitely didn't want to throw away what we had. We had iterated over many of the interfaces. Little tweaks here and there proved insanely powerful. You can automate the tiniest little thing, and your sales and customer service are interacting with customers instead of searching for information or doing data entry. It was a very powerful system for us. But I realized it was at risk. We needed a migration plan. We couldn't stay on Interchange 5 forever. Essentially, we needed to train a gorilla. The problem was that we needed a better development and testing environment. That was primary. We needed the ability to migrate away from Interchange 5 eventually. But we didn't want to throw anything away. I knew the value of testing, but it was really hard to write tests for our current environment. I would say impossible. Most of the code that needed testing was in Interchange HTML templates, meaning you needed a Interchange server and Apache server in your testing environment running to even test anything, which we did, but the tests were useless. We had many, many false starts with testing. Basically, what I learned was when not to write tests. I knew that pretty well. In the end, we had tests that we created, and they never were run. They either took too long to run, or it took too long to set up the environment to run them, or they were broken all the time because they were based on code that was always changing. Their pages were always changing, things were changing, so you were fixing your tests instead of fixing your code. Don't shield your eyes, don't look at this for too long, but this is the kind of thing that was stuck in an Interchange page for us. Lots of SQL, lots of Perl, lots of HTML mix. I can relate to this. I don't know if anybody's read the test tutorial, I can relate to it. When I wrote my first CPAN module shipment, I got into this. I read the docs. I understood testing. It made sense. I had a really nice fixed environment that I was writing my module in. Didn't know extra dependencies around me that hindered the tests. I understood it. I got it. I also started getting into DBIx at the time, and immediately fell in love with it and realized that. That environment, that's what I needed for Interchange 5. That's what I needed to move forward. So the plan that I had in my head was to find a way to move query tags and data tags out of the HTML templates, migrate the query and data tags completely to DBIX calls. And ingest the data into the templates in a more modern way. I started to see all these nice modern frameworks. It was great. I really wanted a way to run my user tag code from a REPL. So rather than the standard interchange 5 development of write your code in a user tag, restart interchange, check your interchange page, did it work, check your error logs, I needed to type the stuff that I was going to type into the user tag straight into REPL and see my results right away. And I needed to be able to write tests that ran the user tag code. That was critical. So the first step was getting DBIx going on my current interchange data. So thanks to DBIC dump, that really wasn't that hard at all. I was able to quickly do things, even though my data sucked, the data was a mess. DBIX let me do some really cool things. So I could right away set up relationships that existed but weren't defined in the underlying database. I could connect my user DB table to my transactions table. And then I could write some really great helper result sets. So even though, like you can see, this data really sucks, if I want to find complete orders, I have to, there's a number of different statuses that they could be in. I have to make sure that the deleted flag hasn't been set. But if I bury this in a DBIX result set, I never have to think about it again. My business logic is in one place, and I don't have 100 different queries in a bunch of different pages that all need to be maintained if we decide to add a status to that's defined as a complete order. I can add it in one place and it's done. So I loved it. That was great. So what I could do was, I'm going to do a lightning talk on some of the details of some of the details of this line right here, the get schema, and also the for each user tag. So I'll do that in my lightning talk. But essentially, what I could do was I could write a user tag or an action map, throw some DBIX hashgraph data straight into a scratch variable, temporary variable. Or I could start writing modules. Instead of writing my code into the user tag, I could move it into modules and simply pass my schema from interchange to the module and get my data. And then in my page, all I did was an alias ArrayRef to object.mvResults. I don't know if anybody knows that handy little feature, but I just did some aliasing to make this nice for my developers. It made sense. For each item in an ArrayRef, give it a prefix, and I can do a little more modern type of templating right from interchange. So this worked. This is great. Being able to run the same code that I had in my user tag from a REPL was key for me. What I've shown here is using develop REPL and then DBIC trace, I could write the exact same code here that I had, that I showed you that I was putting into my user tag. Before I put it into the user tag, I could run it in my REPL, see what queries were being run, which was really useful because I was essentially taking queries and putting them into DBIX calls. So I needed to make sure that they were doing the same thing. Anyways, I could do things like this, see the query, see the data that was coming out right in my REPL. I could essentially develop, and then just when I put it into the user tag, it was ready to go. This was insanely useful. I don't know if anybody uses DBIx fixtures, but so once I defined a lot of my relationships, I could create some fixed data for my tests. So all you do is write a nice little fixture config file, and then create the fixtures based on some existing data. So we had a development database, and I could just grab some fixed data out of the development database into files, and then when I got to writing the test, simply just populate a test database with that fixed data, and then run some tests. So if you go back to the user tag code that I had, so I can just pull out a user DB entry and related transactions. I didn't have to tell DBIx fixtures which transactions I needed. I just said get all the transactions for this customer, and then I get a huge set of fixed data that I could load into my test. Test database, and then there's a bit of magic, not really actually. So I just created a module that reads all of the user tag code into from flat files, and throws it into a hash, so that I can just choose one of the tags that I want to test. So here I'm just taking the code for the orders user tag and evaluating it and then running it. So this all happens without a running interchange server. So it's completely independent of that. Obviously most user tags that I currently had, this wouldn't work. They needed to be rewritten first with DBIx, and because you don't have all of the underlying user tags that your user tag code depended on, like the query tag or the data tag. Obviously that, if you're trying to test a user tag with a query tag or a data tag, that would not have worked at all. But my new tags, anything that I migrated into new tags, this would work really well. So I could just call the user tag and then check that the fixed data, it pulled out the fixed data that I wanted. So I finally had a smart gorilla. It was still 1,000 pounds, but it wasn't pushing me around. So that's it. Thank you very much. Any questions?